my creatives, and thank you so much for joining me today. My name is Irene, and I'm an illustrator and mindful art teacher from the Netherlands. I live in a small village just outside of London, and in these videos I will share with you a little bit more about my life, type of things I'm working on, why I quit my corporate career to work as an artist, type of illustration projects I'm working on, and I'll just generally have a catch-up about things in my life and about art.
In today's video, we are working on our sketchbooks together, so I would invite you to grab your sketchbook as well and some painting or drawing materials and just join in. This video is almost 40 minutes long, so feel free to join me and get creative yourself. I have sped up the sketching part of the video a little bit, but as soon as I get to the inking, I will just play it in real time. The sketch is a little bit too light to properly see on the video, so it's a little bit boring to watch it in real time, so I decided to speed it up a little bit. I do like to make a sketch when I make a drawing like this, because it just helps you making a bit of a plan. Where's everything going to go on the paper? Do I have enough space? Things like that. I quite like painting directly without making a sketch, but I find it much harder. And if I want to make a nice spread in my sketchbook, I tend to make a sketch just to make my own life a little bit easier. So I'm using just a sketch pencil here. I'm working in my Moleskine watercolor sketchbook, and I will also use some ink pens and my watercolor markers. My plan for today's sketchbook spread was to make an illustration inspired by the town that I live in. I've recently moved out of London, and I'm really getting used to a sort of smaller town's life. Everything is walking distance. It is really beautiful around here. When I go for a run, there's cows outside and there's fields, and I'm just absolutely loving it. And I never thought I would say this. I've always been growing up in the city. I've always lived in cities. I've always been a city person. Going to the theater and on nights out, and there's always lots of things to do. But I think at this stage in my life, and especially sort of with lockdown and everything, it's really made me reconsider what I am looking for in life. And I'm really loving this more quiet, more outdoorsy lifestyle, and I've not regretted it for a moment to move here. You never know what the future brings, but now I'm absolutely loving it for now. There's so much beautiful buildings. There's so many beautiful buildings to look at around here. And I get a lot of inspiration out of it at the moment. All these small cottages, old churches, really beautiful old farmhouses. I can't just help and wanting to draw them. So in today's illustration, I am inspired by the town I live in. There's a river in the middle, and I've added some of my favorite buildings from the town to the illustration. It's not a realistic map, it's more sort of inspired by the area. What I'm drawing here now is my own house in the middle, and all the houses around it are sort of buildings that are not too far from me that I really like when I walk past them, and I feel like I should include them in this illustration. Before I moved here, I lived in London. I was there for about 8 years, almost 9 years, and time is going very, very fast. And if you'd asked me 5 years ago, I would never have said I moved to a smaller town. I thought, I don't know what I thought. I sort of expected everyone to know each other's business, and the thought would make me very uncomfortable. But I find that people are really super friendly, and to know people bit local to you is actually quite nice. It's not bothered me so far. I've only found it a positive thing so far. So I'm working in Winsor & Newton waterproof pens here. These are fine liners, and they are markers, and they are waterproof, so I can paint over them later on, which is a lot of fun. The fact that they're waterproof makes a huge difference. I use them all the time, and I just like to be able to paint over areas that are dry. I don't like the I don't like using a pen and then later on having the fear that I will blotch things or that it will bleed out when I play around with water. So I tend to work in waterproof markers quite a lot. And I know you can buy Indian ink that's waterproof as well if you want to work with a brush. And I really love that, but I am quite clumsy and I'm always worried about knocking it over. So a marker works perfect for me. I take them with me quite a lot as well if I go somewhere, or if I am drawing outside, and having a marker and a pencil in your pocket is much easier than a bottle of ink. This church that I'm drawing now is a building not too far from my house, and I actually think there might be people living in there. I don't think it is a working church. And every time I walk past, I think it must be so amazing to wake up every morning looking outside or looking up and seeing the light shine through those stained glass windows. I definitely wanted to include that building in this drawing as well. I run art classes, and in my classes I always paint on loose paper. And working in a sketchbook always feels a bit special for me. I like to fill my sketchbook with the things that I'm a bit proud of, that are completed, finished pieces, and especially in this one, I do my best to make it look to make it look nice and to finish the piece. I do have a few messy sketchbooks as well that I just use for quick drawings and quick ideas and the messier part of my work. But this is one with good paper that I like to keep for slightly nicer paintings and drawings. So it always feels quite special to work on my sketchbook, because I'm painting so much for work that when I work on a sketchbook, it is just really for me and for fun. And I don't have to show it to anyone, and it's just my personal place to express myself. So I really love that, and the fact that I'm sharing a page now, I'm usually quite happy sharing my work, but the fact that it doesn't have to be shared makes it much easier for me to just feel free to create in it. I have a lot of other work that I'm sharing with the world, so I don't have to share what's in my sketchbook, but I just finished one completely, and I might do a sketchbook tour. I'll have to think about it. I am adding some little details in a finer pen. The pen I used first was a little bit thicker, and now I'm adding a little bridge. There's swan. There's some river barges in my illustrations. Some fishermen somewhere. So I'm adding finer little details to my illustration with a finer pen. Having different size pens is again one of these things that just makes life a little bit easier when you're drawing. When I was growing up, when I was in high school, I really wanted to become a children's book illustrator, but I had no idea how to go about it. And I applied to art school, and I did not get in. And I just didn't know how to approach it. I arrived with a sketch pencil and a sketchbook, and I thought that was enough to get me through the application. Whereas everyone else had a whole bag full of different materials and different markers and pens and clay and wool and all this stuff. And I just had no clue. I was absolutely clueless. And in hindsight, it's fine. I don't think I needed to go to art school. I'm sure I would have loved it, but I really loved the things that I went on to do as well. So life is not just a straight path. You can have many windy roads and then end up at the same place without realizing that that was where you were going all along. So I ended up studying law, and then after my degree, which I did in the Netherlands, I moved to London and worked there in the city for about 7 years, and then 2 years ago I left my corporate job and started to work as a full-time illustrator and art teacher, and from then on this is what I do. And of course, running my own business has its challenges. There's parts that are quite hard about running a business. You're responsible for everything you do. No one keeps you accountable, so I have to keep myself accountable every day. And there's definitely parts of being my own boss that are hard sometimes. But overall, I absolutely love it. I love the fact that no one tells me what to do. I can spend my days exactly how I want them. If I want to go for a run in the middle of the day, I can do that. I just absolutely love that. It gives me a lot of freedom. Probably work the same amount of hours as I did before, or even more. But a lot of the work that I'm doing is so fun that it doesn't really feel like work to me. So I do a lot of different things. I'm hosting a podcast. I run this tiny YouTube channel, which hopefully will grow a little bit over the next few months. I am a Skillshare teacher. I teach my own art classes on my own website, on Makings and Musings. I do all my social media accounts, record videos. My day is filled with lots of different activities and different things. And I also illustrate children's books. I am available for commissions. I create art prints and stickers of my own work. So I'm keeping pretty busy. I have lots of different things on and I'm never bored. I can say that with confidence. I always have something to do. And I'm very fortunate that I have my own studio. I did a studio tour before, but that was before I moved house, so I think I should film one again. It's been a little while since I filmed my last YouTube video, and this time, I have moved house. I have my own studio where I teach and where I sit all day. I have a desk with my where I can do my digital work, and I have another desk where I can do all my traditional paintings and artwork. And yeah, maybe I'll show you around at some point. It'll be quite fun to film. I need to tidy up a little bit first because I am pretty messy. Being tidy is one of these things that I love to be. I really like the idea of having a tiny room, and I am pretty organized, so maybe it's messy, but I know where everything is. I'm the only person who really uses this room, so no one else messes it up. I would like it to be a tiny bit tidier. Just so you can make beautiful Instagram photos without having to tidy up first. And that's not a reality for me. I always have to tidy up before I can do anything. It's because I have so many materials and wires and cameras and things around that I need for my work. So there's always stuff out. I'll be quite curious to hear how you guys make your art. And if you're a tidy person, if you're organized, or if everything is in one big pile. I think there's things to say for both of these methods. I like to be a little bit tidier. I am really trying to do some more home studying at the moment. I want to learn more about creativity and about art, about running my own business. And I'm trying to read more nonfiction for that reason. And I'm always a big fiction reader. I love fantasy books. And I love reading. I read quite a lot. But I've never really read much nonfiction. Because when I studied law, I had to read so many books for my studies. And for work, I always had to read a lot. So in the evening, I just wanted to read something relaxing. But now I feel like I need to engross myself more in the world of creativity and learn more and really become like a super expert in this field. So yeah, I've been reading a lot about mindfulness and creativity, and if anyone has some book recommendations, I'd really love to hear them. I think a good book to start with always when you're new to making art, or if you're thinking about making art your career, or if you're thinking about starting a creative business, or just in general if you want to be more creative in your life. I think Wild Magic. Wild Magic? Big Magic. From Elizabeth Gilbert is a great book to start with. She's the author from Eat, Pray, Love, and even though she writes mostly about creative writing, her book really applies to all types of creativity and art. And I think it's a great book to start with. If you don't know where to start, it's quite easy to read, really fun to read, and just really gives you an insight in why people are creative and also why people are not creative, or why they think they're not being creative, or what stops them from pursuing a creative activity, because various fears and scares that we might have, that we all have. Yeah, I really enjoyed reading that. I've passed it on to a friend after I read it, and yeah, I would highly recommend it for anyone who wants to get started on a creative journey. You can see my inking starts to come together. I have added paths, some little details. I think I just added a little fisherman there. There's lots of fishermen along this river. You're not really supposed to swim there, but it is very nice to do that anyway. So, lots of paths. And I think I'm almost ready to start painting. There we are. These are watercolor markers that I treated myself to maybe a year ago, and I really love them. I use them quite a lot, mostly because they are so super convenient. I love the colors, they're quite intense. I like how you can color things in first and go over it with a watercolor brush. And that way, yeah, really make it look like paint, but you keep a certain level of control that maybe with traditional paint it feels a little bit different. So I use these markers quite a lot, mostly for my personal work, not really for anything professional at the moment. I tend to stick with sort of watercolor paint or gouache and then edit digitally. But for work in my sketchbook, this is a lot of fun. And because I only have a small set of these, I instantly give myself a limited color palette, which is quite helpful as well, because having a limited palette just means that you have to be more creative in other ways. So it opens yourself up for thinking about things in different ways than if you have all the colors in the world. It can be a bit overwhelming sometimes. For something like this, where I'm inking first and coloring it in, the watercolor markers are one of my favorite mediums to use. It feels quite fast because you don't have to do lots of preparations to get started. But it probably takes me as long as, you know, with normal paint if I paint it. I use these markers on the go sometimes, and I sit in nature and then make a painting with markers whilst I'm sitting outside, and it's just much easier to carry with me than paint and a bottle of water and all the extra things that I might need. Okay, so I'm starting with the river, coloring it in. If you don't know what to paint, making a map is a lot of fun to start with. I would really recommend it. I'm keeping this video in real time. Sometimes my head pops in and out. I apologize for that. I almost forget that the camera is there sometimes. And then, because the sketchbook is quite small, I tend to lean over and then my head gets in the way. So today is quite a quiet day. I finished a number of books recently. One of them has just been published. It's called Tech the Cat Sings the Blues, and you can buy it on Amazon. The one has just been published. Then I have illustrated a number of other books that I cannot actually reveal too much about. The final illustrations have just been sent off to the publisher, who then is going to review it with the author, see if they're happy with all the details, if there's any revisions needed, and if there's no revisions needed, then I am finished, but I suspect that a few points will come back, because that's what usually happens. So there might be a few little changes that need to be made, but they seem pretty happy about it, so that is good. And it means that I can't really do anything at the moment on that particular project. So I've got lots of other things that I can work on for that project. I just have to wait until I get the feedback, and then I know if I need to do anything or not. So in the meantime, I have some time to create this YouTube video. I'm still running art classes every week, so I keep pretty busy with that. I have time to do a little bit of personal personal work. It's funny that for someone who paints every day, I have very little time for personal work, much less than I suspected when I first started making art. There's just so much other stuff that comes by running a business. Stuff that just takes up much more time than you think. When I grow bigger, if I start selling more art prints, or if my accounts are growing, I would definitely think about hiring a PA, but at the moment it's not quite necessary yet, and I quite like to be on top of things myself. But things like answering emails, maintaining the website, doing social media, answering queries, uploading things, editing videos, all of that takes quite a lot of time. In addition to running art classes where I paint and then doing commissioned work. Sometimes in the evening I don't really want to work on my personal work. I just want to watch a film and chill out or read a book. So I'm definitely doing less personal work than I did before I did this professionally. And that's absolutely okay, because I love working on commissions. For me, when someone tells me what to paint or what to draw, is in no way less enjoyable than painting it for my own imagination. So when I run art classes, I can choose the topics and the references, and that's completely in my hands. So I always pick things that I enjoy and that I like painting. It's definitely a little bit different than I imagined it to be before I did this work. I'm quite curious if any of you run your own art business and what your experience is. You do mostly personal work, or maybe a very small percentage of what you do is your own personal work. So working in my sketchbook today was definitely a luxury. And what I do is I usually play some YouTube videos in the background. So this voice recording was recorded separately. Not very efficient, but it means that whilst I'm painting, I can just really enjoy the painting process without having to think about what to say or what I'm going to talk about. You can see I've added some orange to this building. The stones are a little bit red and I don't have that particular color, so I'm trying to mix it up. So that's one of the things that when you work with a limited palette, you just have to use the colors that you have, and you might not have the precise color that's available, that's in the picture, or in reality, what you see in front of you. You just need to make it up or get as close to it as you can, or just decide to add a completely different color. Sometimes you have to be creative and change things up in a way that fits you. And this is actually my own house that I'm painting now. Mine and the neighbors. So I don't know if my neighbors watch my YouTube channel, but if they do, this is your house. I hope you enjoy it. Will not put any addresses in here, so no one will come and find you, don't worry. So, the problem with these markers, with these watercolor markers, is that sometimes the ink comes out really intense and the color seems really, really dark. And a way to avoid that is by using a palette and add the ink from your marker a bit on a palette first, very similar to if you were painting, and then use the brush to lift it up and use it on the paper. I don't very often do that. I usually go directly with my marker on the paper, but you can definitely use a palette and use it in a much more traditional way to traditional paint. Dilute it a bit first before you go on the paper. I like these harder edges though, and the fact that you instantly get a lot of contrast whilst using watercolor markers. So that's a really beautiful old farmhouse that's not too far from here. Actually it's a pub, I think, but I've not been in there yet, because most things have been closed for a lot of the year. And there's a lot of pubs to try out here, so I've been to a few now. Things are opening, but not to this one yet. I do run past it sometimes. And time to add some grass. So again, you can go to quite big areas of your paper when you use watercolor marker. And my head is popping in again. You can cover quite big parts of the paper just by adding a little bit of the marker here and there and then nicely blending it out and making it all smooth by using a brush with water. The brush that I'm using came from a different set. It's one of those plastic brushes that has the water inside it. And I was really skeptical about this because it doesn't look like a nice brush. I sort of expected it would feel a bit cheap, but the reality is so much better than what I felt, what I feared. And they're not leaking either, this one is not. So I quite often take it with me filled with water, and then I can use it on the go as well. I just don't clean it very well, but that's just one thing. So I'm adding some grass here. I wanted this picture to be quite vibrant and colourful, not too serious. The shape of this book is also quite different from my loose paper, which is always like A3 or A4 shaped. So this really long, elongated shape makes you think about your composition a little bit in a different way, which is fun as well. It's nice to have these little challenges for yourself. You suddenly have to fill a different type of space or use your materials in a different way. You can lift some of the marker from one side and then use it on a different part of the painting. So sometimes I don't add the marker directly to the paper, but rather I would lift it up with some water from a different area and then you insulate a really nice soft color. So that's what I'm doing here. Quite enjoying this artwork. Quite a loose and fun sketchbook spread, not too serious. It was definitely fun to make, and yeah, I'd like to make more maps. I think I will make a bit of a collection of them, maybe some bigger ones as well. I have a big artboard here that I want to fill with something, so maybe I can make a map with all the places that I've visited or traveled to, something like that. Something iconic from every country that I've been to. It's a bit cheesy, but I would quite like it. I also saw this art challenge where you draw 100 animals. I think the original artist did it in 4 days. I don't remember who it is now. I put it in my show notes if I remember. Did 100 animals in 4 days. I don't think I have the time for that, but I like the idea of just drawing lots and lots of animals in a specific style. So I think I might try that as well. I do paint and draw a lot of animals already, but usually not all in ones or one after the other in that way. I thought at this point a few times throughout the painting, I thought, oh, maybe it's time to stop. So I added more color later on. You'll see I made the road yellow and I added more color here and there in the tree. But I did think a few times, oh, it looked quite nice in black and white with just one pop of color. So maybe I'll do that next time. Make a map in black and white and just add one color pop here and there. I thought that'd be a lot of fun as well. I wonder if anyone who lives in the town I live in would recognize this as being a map of the town. I suspect not. There's quite a few big features that I've left out that I probably should have put in if I wanted it to be a recognizable map. But that was not the point of it. It was to my favorite places around where I live. So I've only picked the things that I wanted to draw or that I have been thinking about drawing for a long time.